case to come before the Court of State of Ohio v. Demetrius Carr and Devante Carr. Each party will have up to 15 minutes to present their arguments. The appellant may reserve up to 5 minutes for rebuttal. If you do plan to reserve time for rebuttal, please let me know. I'll try to remind you when you're going into that rebuttal time. The arguments are being recorded, so please stay behind the podium, introduce yourself, keep your voices up. You should not refer to the names of children or minors or victims during your arguments. You can refer to those folks should they be relevant to your argument by initials or terms that are generic. We have read your briefs and we're ready to proceed when you are, and I would just ask the appellant, would you like to reserve time?
Yes, Judge, I'd like to reserve 5 minutes of my time.
Okay, and I would just say the appellees, I know that you have already indicated, you know, that you're supposed to split your 15 minutes.
Your Honor, just in regards to that, my name is Reed Yoder, I represent Demetrius Carr. Demonte and Demetrius have the same arguments that we'd be making, and I'm going to defer my time of 7.5 minutes to Mr. Laybourne.
Very well. And we are ready for you when you are ready to begin.
Good morning. May it please the Court, my name is Rick Raley, and I'm appearing today on behalf of the appellant in this case, the State of Ohio. And I'm here to ask that the Court reverse the trial court's order that excluded certain scientific evidence from being offered at trial. The evidence was a cyber check report prepared by a private company called Global Intelligence. During the course of pretrial proceedings, both the defendants in this case requested proprietary algorithms from Global Intelligence. They actually requested them from the state, but they belong to Global Intelligence. The state indicated we don't have those, we cannot provide them. We can provide everything else you've asked for, but not that. The trial court still ordered that the state produce the proprietary items. And then we could not, the trial court excluded the evidence. So I put one assignment of error for your review, that the trial court abused its discretion by excluding that cyber check report. There are two reasons that I'm putting forward to the court for why that assignment of error should be sustained. Either of them are independently sufficient to reverse the trial court's order. First, and I think is the best argument of the state, is that under 16b, the order exceeded the scope of our obligations under the rules of discovery. It requires the state to produce items within the possession of the state or reasonably available to it. In the state's view, that is not satisfied in this case.
Is this really a discovery issue, or is it an expert testimony Daubert issue? Or we're talking about what the expert relies on when making an opinion.
So the trial court's order is based solely on the rules of discovery, and we have not gotten to a Daubert hearing. The state would like there to be a Daubert hearing. And a lot of the arguments raised by the defendants on appeal and below are relating to reliability of this evidence, but we haven't gotten to that point. Right now it's a discovery stage, and I think it's very clear under the rules of discovery that the state has complied with its obligations. So really, whenever there's an argument here about the underlying science here, that's not for today.
Aren't you supposed to disclose, however, what the expert relies on, according to the rule?
Well, so the expert has disclosed the process that he has used. They're looking for more information about that process. All the items that were requested that we had, we gave. And the second reason that I would request this court to consider, if it does not reach on that first, there are Lakewood factors for determining sanctions on a discovery violation. Although I don't think there was a discovery violation, if there was, I think it's pretty clear that this is not a willful violation on the state's part. The state didn't have it, it couldn't provide it. Also, there was another easier, less severe sanction that was a continuance to subpoena these materials directly from the company that had them. That's provided for in the criminal rules. The defendants could have availed themselves of that procedure, and they did not. For that reason, I think
the proof. But counsel, just so I understand, but the state could not avail itself of getting the information?
I don't know, I mean, perhaps the state could, but there would still need to be a continuance for that purpose, so that the state could have done it as well. But at this point, it's something where, you know, it was not in this particular case where there was a hearing that had discussions with Mr. Mosier. The Rankin case, which was previously handled in common pleas, the transcript from that case was added as an exhibit in this case.
I have a question about adding that transcript as an exhibit. How does that mean that the state doesn't have to, or the defense doesn't have to, give all of that testimony at this hearing? And what does the transcript do? What's the purpose?
Judge, I'm kind of at a loss at that too. I think it's very unusual to do that. At this point, there has been an objection to it below, and I'm kind of stuck with that. But that was a very unusual procedure in my view. However, if you look at that, you know, there was even a request there to Mr. Mosier himself, if there's a stipulated protective order, would you provide it? He says, no, I'm not, it's proprietary. And there's still no order from a court at that time that says you have to turn it over. And until there's that order and the possibility of contempt and some sort of sanctions for that, I don't think it's something that's reasonably available to the state to find it.
The judge uses Rule 16 language in her order, but isn't the sanction really akin to the exclusionary rule? Like, you aren't giving discovery to prove this is reliable evidence, so therefore I'm excluding it.
So the exclusionary rule is only for constitutional violations, which that is not what the trial court used for any of this. So I think that's not worth the proper next for us to think about that. That is a separate issue. I would bring up that I cite in the reply brief the Levine case from North Dakota, perhaps South Dakota, get my Dakotas mixed up, I apologize, where there were constitutional issues that were litigated over a similar failure to disclose proprietary algorithms in that court time. It was the constitutional violation. I can't tell you right now the merits of that because I haven't thought about it because I don't think it's appropriate at this time. So I think that this is very similar, and you know, we can analogize this to the cases where, you know, a defendant's looking for something that occurred in the victim's possession, victim's medical records, victim's items in their house, the victim's house itself. I cite those materials in my briefs to you. It's the same logic here. If those proprietary source codes were sitting over in our office, they would have had them, but they're not. That's why they weren't provided. I think there needs to be another avenue for them to get this before we have an Auburn hearing.
But doesn't the state have an interest in knowing that it's reliable?
So the state currently doesn't have any reason not to disbelieve its reliability. It has been used in previous cases without objection. There have been times where, it's not in the record, where it actually shows the exculpatory information about somebody. So at this time, there's no concern internally about that. However, you know, that's something that the reliability is something that has to be proven in court. It's not something that we just decide on our own, sua sponte, that we're going to dump it. I would just note real quickly that the Rankin Coat case was argued last month before this court. I believe Judge Hensel was on that panel with Judge Carr and Judge Stevenson. Sort of bring that to your attention that there may be two opinions on this issue. And I do want to emphasize here, as I did in the Rankin case, the importance of a decision on the merits of these discovery issues. There are multiple court orders now. There are multiple cases pending about this evidence, about these discovery issues. I filed it under Rule 12K because I do think it's an appeals right. However, if this court decides that I need leave, I had filed a motion for that leave at the time of the filing of the appeal. I'd ask you to give that leave and you issue that decision. I think the trial court badly needs this guidance.
Well, is the state asking for a Daubert hearing before these discovery disputes arise or while they're arising?
No, so the discovery is phase one, then we get to Daubert hearing. We're still here. So I don't think that the state wants a Daubert hearing until we resolve these discovery issues.
But obviously they're intermixed because we're talking about what the experts are relying on.
Correct, but I think that in terms of discovery, if they want that information, they should use the avenues available to them to obtain it. One avenue that's clearly not available to them is they can't ask the party that doesn't have it to get it. That doesn't make any sense, it's not required in the law.
Well, how do you even know what's relevant and discoverable if you don't know what the expert's relying on to make an opinion?
Well, this isn't about saying that they shouldn't request a judge, it's about they did request it and we don't have it.
Is that it could be discoverable, it could be exculpatory.
It could be. That's something that they have to request from the company. Now we get analogized to those cases.
The exculpatory would be the duty of the state to give it over.
Well, again, if the state has it, they understand that they would have to turn it over, yes. But we don't have it. So with that, I would reserve the rest of my time.
Thank you.
Good morning, Your Honors. Attorney Jeff Laybourne on behalf of both Demetrius and DeMonte Carr. Myself and Mr. Munyer represent DeMonte Carr. Mr. Yoder represents Demetrius Carr. We believe that they have very similar issues here today, so I'm going to argue for both. Good morning. I think it's important because this is such new technology here that, is at issue that, and I know Judge Hensel, you were on, the other hearing, so I'll try to be brief, to talk about what CyberCheck purports to be. It's a proprietary software, 1 million lines of code, 740 algorithms. This is based upon testimony from Mr. Mosier, who is the owner and founder of, CyberCheck. An ask from the Akron Police Department in this situation goes to CyberCheck, can check on this day, on this particular individual, and after a number of days, it spits out a percentage likelihood that that person or their phone was at the scene of the alleged crime. There's purported to be no human eyes on, the software. The software and the company does not collect or store or clone the data, which is important. We'll get to that, later. And they purport that this information is, found through open source codes just on the internet. What we don't know is if this information is coming from the dark web, the deep web, the surface web, because there is no data associated with the result on our cases. And so, because there's no record or clone or copy, and because Mr. Mosier and CyberCheck refused to turn over the proprietary information, our experts at, Vestige Technologies are unable to replicate or duplicate or authenticate on any level the report that has been used here. So the issue becomes, as this court brought up, you know, a Daubert hearing, we are unable to prepare for that Daubert hearing. So with no information to provide to our experts, there is no way for us to, and the Carr brothers, to properly and appropriately prepare for that hearing, because there's no information. That's number one. Number two, Mr. Mosier and CyberCheck have been on the record in multiple courts, including this case, these cases here, that he is not going to and never going to turn over that information.
How is this different than the cases he cites about not being able to discover like how a machine works?
Or, sure, sure.
Like, you don't have to know every scientific method of a machine.
Right, and I don't, I appreciate it, and I don't think that our experts are, requesting that or that we're requesting that, but we need some information, because right now we have none. And then this causes an additional concern for the defense. If this data that was collected to make this result was obtained illegally from the dark web, then we have potential suppression issues that we are unable to explore, because we do not know where this data originates. And so if I have Vestige, our experts, go in and try to replicate this and use information from the dark web, I believe they'd be committing a crime. And so we just want to ensure that they're, number one, we can prepare for a Daubert hearing, and number two, that there are not, or that there may be, suppression issues in how it's collected. And another reason this is so important, Your Honors, is that this is just such unusual technology. This is never, CyberCheck never patented this, this technology. They have never had it peer reviewed. This technology has not been adopted or used or contracted with the Federal Bureau of Investigation, who's on the razor's edge of criminal technology here. They have stayed away from it. So what we're completely reliant upon then, because there's no peer review, there's no patent, there's no other company or entity doing this, is the word of CyberCheck and the word of Mr. Mosier, which is shown to be faulty. And I'm being kind here.
But hasn't he explained in other cases how the technology works, like GPS location on this app and GPS location on this app make this?
He has made those assertions, Your Honor, but has never provided any documentation to support that.
But isn't the phone, the actual phone, the underlying, what the person is relying on to...
Purportedly from Mr. Mosier, but we don't know how. And so the issue is that there's no way to verify or replicate what he's saying. So we're just left to rely on his word. And so the defense contends that Judge Michael properly granted that motion to compel and ordered Mr. Mosier in 48 hours to turn over that information.
Didn't you order the state of Ohio to turn over that information, not Mr. Mosier?
That's correct, yes. And Mr. Mosier is the state of Ohio's purported expert witness. Mr. Mosier is who the state of Ohio, through the Akron Police Department, has a contract with. The state of Ohio has communication back and forth with Mr. Mosier about court dates, about asks, about this technology. So here, Mr. Mosier is a state actor on behalf of the state.
Was the contract in the record?
The contract is not in the record, as it was stated in the oral arguments for State v. Rankin. I believe that Mr. Raley, and you can correct me on this, that the state, or that Mr. Raley has never seen the contract and does not know what it involves, but I know that there was, I believe it's terminated now, there was a contract with APD.
I'm still cart before the horse. I mean, if there's evidence that he's relying on it as an expert and that's disclosed to you somehow, like through a Dauber, then wouldn't you be able to get your own expert to look at that same information? I mean, that wouldn't involve the propriety of
Sure, but we don't know what Mr. Mosier is going to say because he hasn't turned anything over. So our experts have nothing, they can't do anything at this point to help.
You would be able to question him about his methods? Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, how he came up with this number, which is, that's the thing that's getting presented to the jury. And by the way, this is the evidence that they have against the car brothers, is this cyber check report. And at the end of this trial, this is why this is so important and I'm impassioned, life without parole. So let's get it right. Let's find out what it is. I don't think it's legitimate based on what I've seen, but let's find out. And Judge Michael, that's what she was asking for, and these other judges that have ordered the state, let's find out. If it's all on the up and up, show us. So show us your work. Show us how you got there. I've got two sons, and all three of us are struggling with their math homework right now, right? And we're doing long division, and you go through it. Here's the question, and you go through and you show your work, and you have an answer. What CyberCheck's trying to do here is write the answer down, circle it, and erase how you got there. If my son turns that homework in, that's wrong. He got the right answer, maybe, but he didn't show his work. And if a note comes home to me that says you need to show your work, the judge's order to the state in this analogy, and we just put the answer again and don't show our work, it's still wrong. Now, the state wants to say that this information is not in their possession. And I believe them when they say that. But the rule of discovery states that they're to turn over what's in their possession or reasonably available to it. This is their expert witness with this company. They have a contract with this company. They communicate with the Summit County Prosecutor's Office. And what I would like to ask the state is, what efforts have they made to obtain this information? They want the defense to issue a subpoena to CyberCheck. What efforts have they made? Our subpoena would do nothing. He said he wouldn't comply with it at all. I think the court was appropriate in asking, what concerns do you have about the reliability of this information? And so, you know, the state is in a position to say to their expert, to who they've contracted with, we will get this information from you, CyberCheck, under a protective order amongst ourselves. We will give it to the technology divisions of the Akron Police Department and the local office of the FBI, which they all have cyber divisions, turn it over to them, let them verify it. It will never be in the hands of someone that's not in law enforcement. That's what Judge Michael offered here.
So you're saying this isn't that severe of a sanction because they can have another cybersecurity expert look at the same material.
Sure, their own experts.
This particular independent contractor who won't give up proprietary information.
Right.
He's not the only person available to the state.
Absolutely. So it happens pretty routinely where there is some cyber evidence or technology, and they'll send it off, Summit County Prosecutor's Office, State of Ohio, will send it off to the cyber division of the FBI, say verify this, debunk this, whatever the case may be, and they have done none of that to my knowledge. And so then what we're left with is them saying, you know, file a send off a subpoena, or we want a continuance. If you'll notice, and you have the transcript in front of you, in the hearing on the motion to compel, the words subpoena or continue or continuance were never used. The state didn't ask for a continuance. The state didn't say, well, geez, Mr. Carr, Mrs. Carr, send a subpoena to CyberCheck. So I submit that that argument is waived. Not to mention that the state of Ohio was ordered by the judge to get this information, not the defense. They had the obligation, the requirement to do it pursuant to court order, and they don't know. So then now they're here saying, well, exclusion is not the remedy. They knew the stakes here. We served a detailed discovery request, which we attached to our brief, on June 7, 2023 to the state of Ohio. And it was all CyberCheck related. This is what we want. After talking to our experts, this is what we need to verify this. And in our motion to compel, they knew the stakes. They knew the stakes when they indicted on an aggravated murder where life without parole is at the end of this. So they're arguing that this is the most severe sanction. The most severe sanction would be for Judge Michael to dismiss the case. She didn't do that. She gave them an opportunity to comply, and they knew what would happen if they did not. Exclusion of the evidence. And that's exactly what she did. And what we're talking about here, Your Honors, I think, when you boil it all down, is we're talking about fairness. So if DeMonte Carr presented a report to the state of Ohio during the litigation of this case, and it was from a cyber alibi expert, and we had a report that showed that DeMonte Carr was at the top of a mountain all alone in Colorado, and that's our alibi. And if the state asked the defense, rightly so, as the defense has done in this case, well, how did you come up with that? And my alibi expert said, I'm not going to tell you. They would be jumping up in town. And that evidence would be excluded. And that's what they're doing here. Let's take it a step further. My cyber alibi expert has lied under oath in court proceedings, which their expert has done. And we've shown.
Counsel, but if no one has subpoenaed, whether it's the state or the defense, has subpoenaed Mosier, and we're just relying on him saying, I'm not going to give up that information, it's proprietary, wouldn't it be just like, well, we would have a witness come in and testify, but that person refused, is not here. Wouldn't the trial court require that that witness be subpoenaed?
Sure. I think that the state could issue a subpoena. The trial court could enforce that. In addition to him saying that he's not going to comply, he's been very clear on that. The issue becomes, you subpoena, and he doesn't comply, and then the Carr brothers are in the same spot where their appointed experts are unable to flush out a suppression issue or prepare for a doc. And so they're using this procedural technicality as a sword. We have procedural rules and regulations in place, as a shield, and rightly so, to protect the defendants, to protect the state of Ohio, to protect victims. Here, they're saying, well, we don't have it technically, and they could have subpoenaed it, or we could continue. They're using this, this procedure over the substance of an aggravated murder case. And again, the reason we're here is because the state could not proceed without CyberCheck, meaning that this is the evidence in the case. And so the substance of the case here outweighs the procedure, in my opinion. And I'll just close on this. If the state is saying that the remedy is to send it back and have a Daubert hearing, which I've explained why that would be problematic. If this is all going to be resolved in a Daubert hearing, wouldn't we want that information now, nonetheless? So I would ask the court to affirm the decision of the trial court, and I thank you for your time.
Thank you, counsel. Counsel, you have
Thank you, judges. I'll just wrap up with a couple of final points, if I could. The trial court did order the state of Ohio to produce this information. That is absolutely true.
So is Adam Mosher an agent of the state?
Absolutely not.
Or is he a private actor?
He's a private actor. He has a contract with the Akron Police Department that makes him a contractor. He's not transformed into an agent of the state. So I would fundamentally disagree with that description of him being a state actor. He's not like BCI. It's a completely different situation. The rules are not being used as a sword here. They are being used as a shield. The state of Ohio was ordered to do something it could not do. Judges, you could order me right now to hike up Mount Everest, and I just can't. I'm sorry. That same kind of thing that happened here. Everything else that was asked that the state had was provided. It's not fair for the state of Ohio to, at this time, lose the ability to prosecute a case because a private actor has not given something that has not even been ordered to provide yet. So the motion to compel hearing, you will not see the words continuance in their subpoena because it's about our obligation to produce this information. So it's not to the point of sanctions at that point. Also, the times that, unfortunately, during that hearing, the state was cut off several times to provide more arguments because the judge wanted to do what she was going to do. So I would say that this is not about whether this particular proprietary algorithm should be turned over. This is about, at this point, someone who doesn't have them has been ordered to do it. And when we didn't, our case was destroyed. That's not a fair result in the rules of criminal procedure. They don't allow that kind of result. So I do think it's very clear there should be a reversal, and I'd ask you to do that. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you both for your presentations. The court will take the matter under advisement and issue a decision in due course. Clerk of Courts will mail a copy of that decision to you on the day that it is released, and it will also be posted on the Ohio Supreme Court website. Thank you again for your presentations.